It's a quiet night in the city, unless you're selling hot dogs. If you are, and you pick the wrong place, it could be war.
Don't give me that. I'll stick you through the in the cooking pan. Let me have a look at that license, man. Let me have a look at that license. Leave for lunch. Let's have a look at that license.
To be your own boss?
My baby works in a hot dog stand, making them hot dogs.
Want to make a new start with your redundancy settlement? There's money in hot dogs and hamburgers, so they say. The more you work, the more you earn. At least that's what Dave and Jane Warren were told. Disillusioned, they've now quit the hot dog world.
It was a rip-off. Definitely. I mean, well, shall we say a rip-off? I mean, you go in really with your eyes closed. You don't know what you're going into. We regard ourselves as reasonably respectable people, and we thought that the rest of the people in there would be the same. And it must be true to say that a lot of them are really good people. But then there was the sharks, the people who'd been in it all their life. They knew exactly what was happening. They knew the business inside out, and did take you for a ride right the way down the line.
It's often a far cry from those promises in the business opportunities pages of newspapers.
Earn several hundreds daily, literally thousands from single events.
So how has this lady done?
Terrible. We were just cons from the very beginning. Into expecting, you know, to earn a good wage, quite a bit of money, and it just never worked out like that.
In fact, Pauline Frogson's little venture has lost her £27,000.
There's a lot of people gone bankrupt and have just had to sell the catering vans because they can't afford to go on.
So we decided to go into the business ourselves. To have a closer look from the inside. We're concentrating on two main areas which appear to dominate the business. The big sports and music events, where it's said that backhanders buy the only sites that make real money, and the city streets, where the common currency is violence. First stop, the annual conference of the Mobile and Outside Caterers Association, where violence was high on the agenda.
This guy come along and said that it was his sister, and he told me to get off, and he said if I didn't get off in 10 minutes, it would wreck the van. I said, OK, like, fine, and I started to pack up, and he just walked back up and picked me up and started throwing me on the floor, and then he just walked off. His missus shouted him.
My wife and son and myself have been threatened. We've had the heavies sat in our house, and we've been told we either pay up or they take the trailer away.
We made a modest beginning, a shiny new handcart and a false moustache. This was to be a journey into a world of graft and violence, of profitable payouts and painful payoffs. At first, no one took much notice of us. There weren't enough customers at our chosen pitches to fight over. So we headed for the bright lights, where we knew trade was good. Outside Tottenham Court Road tube station in London, a prime inner city site. It's 7 o'clock, we're all fired up and ready to go. A council license to trade on this pitch.
I'm not going to show somebody as rude as you.
I bury you on this tonight, my friend.
You what?
I bury you on this tonight.
You bury me? How? If you park there, you're trying to close me down, are you?
Yeah, yeah.
Shall we call the police?
Yeah, go to call the come on, go together. Come on.
The heavies lost no time in arriving.
Go together, the police.
Let's call the police. I have a license.
First, they parked their trailer right across ours.
Your characters will do something nasty to my van.
Someone already going. Go and look the police station. Go and ask it.
I wouldn't trust you. Leave it alone. Leave it alone.
The heavies turned up in three waves. Our legal activities threatened theirs, which were beyond the law and strictly cash in hand. They think nothing of paying £100 a day in fines. They'd already threatened to destroy our cart if I didn't leave. I didn't, and they did. 12 in all, they made it clear that the consequences would be fatal if we tried again. No one, even with a license, was going to get in their way.
Well, you're the governor now, are you? All this has been filmed. All the threats, all the violence, the smashing up of this, is the way you normally behave, isn't it?
I come up to you and asked you nicely, you said no. So I said to you, you're going to regret it. You don't listen, though, do you?
That was a threat, was it?
Was it a threat?
Yes.
That was our threat.
Because this is what's happened. You said I'd regret it. And,
no, I said to you, regret. See, I don't know what's happened.
Are you the boss?
I'm the governor, yeah, go on.
You're the governor.
Yeah, carry on.
You're David.
Yeah,
there have been three Davids so far.
Plenty of Davids.
Plenty of Davids. And you run the West End for burgers.
Me, I run the planet, mate. The West End, I run the planet.
And this is what you do to people?
Yeah.
This is what you do to people
that's
who...
That's it, mate, yeah. Don't like it. Tough, innit?
Unfortunately, that's how it is in the hot dog world. I was legal, and now I'm out of business. He's illegal and very much in business. And you saw how he managed that. The hot dog business is run on violence.
In almost every city we went to, we found hot dog kings who thought they ruled the planet. Kings who rule by fear. King of kings was Gary Thompson. It was the murder of Gary Thompson in Leicester last October that first alerted us to the physical and financial perils of the hot dog industry. Gary Thompson died violently, shot as he returned home with tens of thousands of pounds in weekend takings. Weighing in at 25 stone, a millionaire with connections in London, Glasgow, Manchester and Liverpool, he'd drawn together the lucrative threads of this disparate business. Thompson's last journey was made in style, and the van at the rear made it obvious what had paid for that style.
Now that Gary Thompson's died, I mean, now everybody wants a piece of what he's left, and it's just turned into, like, some kind of war.
I had a visit in the night and somebody's thrown three petrol bombs in the van.
Dick By is a small operator with three vans and poses a threat to nobody, you'd think.
Well, you can see what a mess it's made.
Yes, I can. Right, let's have a good look then.
Well, there's a lot of animosity in the hot dog world at the moment and a lot of ill feelings. I'll probably upset somebody along the line.
Leicester was home to Gary Thompson as well as to Dick By. So it was here we decided to try our luck next with a bigger unit, a hot dog trailer. Once again, we were operating legally with a council licence for our chosen pitch. Even so, we had unwelcome visitors.
And let me have a look at that license, man. Let me have a look at that license. Leave my life. Let's have a look at that license. I'm going to have a license. Get out of here. All right. Get out. Now.
Okay. Just that. Okay.
Let's have a look at that.
So, just who was this agitated man with the colourful English? To find out, we went back to the film of Gary Thompson's funeral. And there, amongst the mourners, we found him, a man not long out of prison after serving 5 years for kidnapping and torture. He's Joe Persico, Gary Thompson's former first lieutenant. Persico is apparently trying to take over the Thompson empire.
Gary used to like to buy people out. Joe wants to buy people out, but with violence. He wants to drive everybody else out of business. You know, and if he's into show, you know, he won't think nothing of them, like either turning them off or tipping them over or threatening the staff.
Okay.
What type of person is Joe Persico?
He's a very, very, very violent person.
Unpredictable?
Very. If they've got a better pitch than him, he'll move their vehicle with his vehicle, put it in the middle of anywhere. He'll turn the gases off, he'll cut the gas pipes on the unit, he'll terrorise as many people as he can if they're affecting his business. You can never predict him. He's like a mad dog.
But Persico was true to his word. He closed us down, dragged our van off its blocks, and towed it away. Undeterred, but a little wary of the mean streets, we decided to change venue, to abandon battle with the illegal traders, and to set up where everyone was legal. Trading as Happy Burgers, of course. We applied to a major catering concessionaire for a pitch at one of the big Easter events. The World Superbike Championship at Donington Park.
No! Like that.
The price of a pitch was £500 for the weekend. But then some of the large multi-unit operators boast of taking as much as £100,000 at big events.
Waiting for burgers?
Violence is relatively rare. The problem is being in the right place to make a profit. The catering concessionaires at Donington were Concert Publishing. We'd heard about them at the Mobile Caterers annual conference.
And I think of the Monsters of Rock at Castle Donington last year, being told that there would be from 60 to 100 other caterers. When you get there, you find that there are 160. So you then go along to these people called Concert Publishing, and you ask them why this is so, and they say, you can imagine they use two words, and one's four letters, the other one is three. Do you know what I mean?
As it was, we didn't even cover our costs. We'd been promised a good site and that we'd be the only unit selling dogs and burgers in our area. Both promises were false. So what makes a good site? Nick Johnson, former operator of 11 hot dog trailers, explains.
Well, the thing is, with fast food, it's impulse buying. If you've got to go off the beaten track to get something to eat, people just won't bother. As you can see, the units around here, the bar's doing nothing. The burger unit's doing nothing. I mean, it's a bad sight.
But these people would have come on a good promise.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Everybody gets the good promise. We're all going to come here and make a lot of... We're all going to be millionaires, but if we're going to find this on next year, they won't be here. They'll have done the brains, gone bust.
Right in the middle of that bad sight was newcomer Anne Matthews.
You know, I was led to believe on the fact that there was going to be lots of people buying and stuff like that, so I bought in a lot of stock. I bought too much food, far too much food. It's all going to be thrown away and wasted, and that's the majority of my money gone. And it's just, I don't know, I'm just so upset about it. I really am.
The man who sold Anne and us our pitches is Concert site manager Nobby Anderson.
Why it is you've been making false promises to people about the kind of money they can earn. We tried it for ourselves and couldn't possibly have covered our costs.
We don't really sort of make anybody any promises. All we do is we sell space.
Do you now? You also made a promise saying we would not have any opposition close to us. And we did. We had a much bigger trailer in a better position. He did the business, we didn't.
Well, what do you regard as opposition?
You were selling burgers just like we were.
Well, I'm not a caterer.
So what reaction did Anne's predicament prompt?
Oh, tears. It really does.
And had the weekend really lost her £800?
Yeah.
I've got nothing to hide because I know this is a very, very dodgy industry anyway. And I'm not fanning you either.
We've actually talked to a lot of people who are not very happy, including right. some who say they've had to give backhanders to get a decent sight.
Really? Mm. Well, that's something I can't comment on.
But Nick Johnson can comment.
As I know that things, in certain instances whereby I know that people have paid four figures, backhanders, to take jobs on.
To whom?
To the organisers.
And you've done that?
With concert. Yeah, we've seen Nobby Anderson well in the past.
Meanwhile, Nobby was rethinking.
Now, someone has had it off at the end of a few days. Well, I mean, it's a very sort of rough sort of phrase to use, but I'm talking as it actually is. Someone wants to go, oh, very happy, Nobby, there we go. Here, have a pony in your bin. Like, 25 quid, have a drink. I mean, that's not expected, but, I mean, people do that. I mean, I'm a working man, I earn a few quid a week. Someone walks up with a pony and goes, here, here's a bit in your back bin. Little bonus, sweet ass, isn't it?
Concert Publishing operate from smart offices in Islington. The boss is John Collins.
What about greasing palms to make sure you get a better sight? Because as we all know, there's some good sights at any event and some pretty bad ones.
Yeah, I'm sure that goes on. But it's not something I agree with. But then again, I'm sure that it goes on. I mean, there are people that we deal with on a regular basis. And if they say, you know, we would like to go there and we'll do more business with you, maybe they will, you know. That's no different than any other business, is it really?
Well, yes, it is. I mean, we didn't know.
Well, no, but you're new at it. Hopefully, when you've been doing it a bit longer, maybe you will know.
Newcomers, maybe, but the odds were stacked against us. Concert claimed they'd sold 33 pitches. We counted 45. Some did well, most did badly, and not all through incompetence either. Par for the course, according to Roy Norris.
My advice to anybody that wants to go out into the catering world and spend either the redundancy money or the savings, it is very easy to go out and buy a catering unit. The hardest job is getting the work for it. It's a dog-eat-dog world out there, and if you want to go into the shows and events side of it, you can be ripped off left, right and centre with high rents and low takes, and even get beaten up at the end of the day if you're not very careful.
Nevertheless, the siren call of fast money from fast food keeps luring the newcomers in. And in Leicester, the hot dog war is hotting up. Joe Persico's cousin has had a dead pig dumped in his Land Rover. The corpse had Joe's name carved on it and a scar where Joe has one on his face. All very mafia. Eventually, Joe Persico returned our phone calls.
Listen, Roger. Right, listen. I don't deny that I fiddled my tax and I fiddled the VAT, right? And anybody tried standing near any of my units, right? I mean, I'm willing to have like the meeting with you, you know what I mean?
First, we met Phil Bennett, the smiling axe man who serves as Persico's minder.
You can scare him with an axe. I'm sure if someone pulled an axe on me, I'd be scared. You know what I mean? It works both ways, right? It's like there's been bars and everything, right? But it's only like front. They ain't actually been used on anybody.
How does somebody new to the business know that? If somebody like you, with a determined look on his face, arrives with an axe, they're going to go away, aren't they?
Yeah, I reckon they are. Well, most of the time.
And then Joe Persico himself, a violent, unpredictable, even an unstable man.
No, I won't agree with that.
You lose your temper extremely quickly. You can be Mr. Nice Guy 1 minute and raving the next.
Well, it only takes 1 minute to smash a glass into somebody's face, doesn't it?
No, but you can be like this over a hot dog pitch, for example.
Not really, no.
Well, you did it to us. You leaped on our hot dog van straight over the counter.
What do you mean I leaped onto it?
You leapt straight over the counter.
I can't remember doing that. Honestly, I can't remember leaping over it, did I?
You did.
It must have been a very springy, energetic, hyperactive move that night.
You have never been violent towards anybody? You have never destroyed anybody's property?
I've done in the past, yes.
Hey?
People have no right to be frightened of you?
Our boss got us a license.
Who can you do that? Where's the boss? This ain't a f***ing proper life. It don't stink, bitch. Right, get the f*** off me.
Yeah. What do you mean exactly? But people don't have no right to be frightened of me.
You've given nobody cause ever to be frightened of you. I mean, people say you're an evil man.
Well, it's the eye for, you know, it's the eye for the eye, isn't it? The eye for the eye, tooth for the tooth. Somebody's good to me, I'm twice as good to them. Somebody's bad to me, I'm twice as bad to them.
That's the law of the jungle, is it?
It is a jungle. The hot dogs isn't a business, it's a rat race. It's a rat race.
Out on the streets, it's council enforcement officers who have to try to clear up the mess. And in Westminster, they've come up with a rather ingenious answer.
Legislation has come in, it's given us more power. It has enabled us for the first time, when we approach these individuals and ask them to stop trading, to act physically, remove their stalls, their trolleys, for evidence purposes, to be taken to court. And in fact, yesterday, we took 10 of these traders to court, and in a lorry, we took along 10 of the trolleys for evidence for the court to see.
The court can hit the illegal traders where it hurts by seizing their trailers permanently. Some of those in this yard belong to the boss of that man in Tottenham Court Road, who claimed to rule the planet.
So why do you, when people set up quite legally on licensed pitches, why do you send your heavies to smash up? Why didn't you leave us alone? We were perfectly legal where we were. Why did you send your heavies to turn over and smash up our perfectly legal van? Why do you threaten people and scare them off? You have no right.
I don't threaten nobody.
Your heavies do. You sent them back and they turned our van over. You know they did.
It's the mafia or something. It's a businessman. Who are you talking about?
You say you've got nothing to do with him. Leave him alone.
No.
Now you say, you look at the pictures, would you? That is you, and these are your men turning over.
And this is the same man, caught on camera, in Tottenham Court Road. Ozdemir Mahmut is a man with a liking for violence and a criminal record.
Do come out. Why won't you answer questions about the way you violently try and control hamburgers in the West End, eh? There is no answer for your kind of behaviour, is there? There's absolutely no answer for your kind of behaviour.
Ozdemir Mahmut is still in business. The man who drove him away was setting up on our old pitch within the hour. Our files on hot dog wars are now in the hands of the police. Joe Persico is still in business, armed with an axe and a sledgehammer, following a shotgun attack on his father's home. And by rather different means, concert publishing continues to prosper.
I don't twist anybody's arm to come on a job.
What you can be fairly sure of is that the people at the top in the hot dog business probably got there at other people's expense. Take our word for it.